went down to the Crimson River, left my burdens on the shore. I went down a sinner, came up a saint, died with Christ. Now I'm reborn. Yes, he washed me in his mercy, and he cleansed me with his blood.
Sorrows, he made them his very own. about this.
When with the ransom in glory, his face I at last shall see, 'twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. Singing, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Singing, how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
Voices, sing out to the Lord. Here we go.
How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, oh, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
In the book of Genesis, we learn that there was a garden in the very beginning. In the beginning, God made man and placed him in a garden called Eden. Eden means perfect. It means pleasure. It means delightful. God took man and dug into the earth, and he formed man with his own hands. He breathed into man's nostrils the breath of life, and he became a living soul. And he put man in this garden. He put man in this paradise. He put man in this pleasurable place, a delightful place. He gave him a perfect environment. He then took and made him a wife, took a rib from his body and made him a wife. So now he has a family, and man had it made. All he had to do was be obedient and submissive to the will of God for what God wanted for his life. He said, you can have whatever you want. You can have of any tree, of any fruit of the garden. I want you to conquer this world. I want you to be fruitful and multiply. You can have everything. You're the king of this world, if you will. You can have it all. But you cannot take of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Just one rule. Just one responsibility. If you will do these things, you will have it made. And we know what took place because of man's sin. They went and took of the fruit. And God said, the day that ye shall eat of this, ye shall surely die. And we know that death has plagued humanity from that point on. Adam was cursed. Eve was cursed. This world was cursed because of their rebellion, because of their disobedience, because of Adam's choice to rebel against the command of God. And Adam decided to do his own thing. Adam decided to perform his own will. He said, not your will, God, but my will be done. I will do my own thing. And in that moment of rebellion, in that moment of disobedience, mankind was plunged into condemnation. Because of that, this whole world is under the condemnation of sin. For by as one man, sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so that all have sinned. This garden, it began as a garden of delight. It began as a garden of pleasure and a garden of perfection. But because of man's choice to disobey God, because of man's choice to do his own thing, it was plunged into devastation and death. This first garden We find sin enters into the world through this garden. In this first garden, we see that death and condemnation, bitterness, all of these things, the curse of the world, is all because of that first garden and man's choice to do his own will. Well, if we fast forward, we find that we are at the night of the Last Supper. We're at the night that Jesus held the first communion with his disciples. And he explained to them and helped them understand that this Passover meal that they had been taking part of throughout all of the centuries, that when Israel came out of Egypt, he said all that was doing was pointing to me. He said, I am the Passover lamb. I'm going to give my body to be broken on the cross so that you could be free and delivered. I'm going to shed my blood so that you could be forgiven, so your sins could be wiped away. And he shares all of this with them, but he also shares that this is going to be a devastating night. This is going to be a heartbreaking night. In this night, he's going to be betrayed by one of his disciples. In this night, he's going to be denied by one of his closest friends and closest disciples, the Apostle Peter. In this night, they're all going to abandon Jesus. Listen, they're going to fulfill what the Old Testament says, that the shepherd will be smitten and the sheep will scatter. And Jesus knows all of this. And he goes into a garden. They leave the upper room and they cross over the brook Kidron. And they go into the Garden of Gethsemane. In John chapter 18, verse 1, it says, when Jesus had spoken these words, he went forth with his disciples over the brook Kidron, where was a garden, and in the which he entered and his disciples. Matthew says that Jesus came to the place that's called Gethsemane. That's the name of the garden. And he said unto his disciples, sit ye here while I go and pray. Now there's so much we can learn from just the place. This place that we find Jesus at this particular point in time, you see, this place was not just any ordinary place. As we cross over the brook Kidron, Kidron means mournful. It means sorrowful. It uses the term ashy or dark. And in that day when they would mourn or grieve or would be in great sorrow, they would put ashes upon their head. And Kidron means sorrowful. And Jesus is crossing over the brook Kidron, going up the Mount of Olives to a place called Gethsemane. Gethsemane all by itself, the word means an olive press. And how appropriate to what is taking place in this night. You see, an olive press was used. They would take the olives and put it in a big vat, and they would crush the olives and apply pressure to the olives till the oil came out. And in this night, we're going to find Jesus in the darkest hour of his day. We're going to find Jesus in the most pressurized time of his whole ministry here on earth. We're going to find Jesus in the loneliest hour. We're going to find Jesus in a time that where he says that he is exceedingly sorrowful even unto death. You see, there's no single verse in Scripture, not one single verse that tells us that Jesus ever laughed. Not one single one, but it does say that Jesus wept. Jesus was grieved. Jesus, he wailed over Jerusalem. He wept at Lazarus in the situation where Lazarus had died. And all of these things we see that Isaiah was so accurate. Isaiah 53:3 says, he is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. We hid as it were our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Watch this now. Surely he hath borne our griefs. That means to lift. Born means to lift. He lifts our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. As we see this garden experience, we're going to find Jesus was truly a man of sorrows. He was acquainted with our grief. He was acquainted with our burdens. He was acquainted with our sorrow. In the garden, this place of sorrow, let's see as Jesus shows us what to do when we're under great temptation.
Jesus climbed the hill to the garden still, his step.
Jesus takes his disciples into the garden, and he leaves eight of them at the very entrance of the garden. And he takes his most trusted followers, his inner circle, if you will, Peter, James, and John. And he goes a little further, the Bible says, and he tells them, my soul is exceeding sorrowful even unto death. Jesus is feeling the pressure of the moment. He's feeling all of what's taking place or what's fixing to take place. And he's expecting and he's asking his closest friends, those who are closest to him, and say, will you please pray? Would you pray with me? Will you watch with me? Will you be with me in this time of agony and of stress? And he said, pray here. And then the Bible says he went a stone's throw, maybe 30, 40 yards away. And he went a little further. And he began to pray and he began to beg God. And there are so many things that took place here. He begins to say, Lord, let this cup pass from me. Oh, my Father. Oh, my Father. He said, I know all things are possible with thee. I know all things are possible with thee. If it be thy will, let this cup pass from me. Let this cup pass from me. But nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. This is such an amazing prayer. We see Jesus who came to die. We see Jesus who said that his purpose in life was to go to the cross. He came to be the Lamb of God, which was slain. He came to be the Lamb of God that would be sacrificed and take away the sins of the world. I've heard people say, heard commentaries say that Jesus was afraid of the cross. He had a fear of what was to come. He was afraid of the beating that he was going to endure. He was afraid of being nailed to a cross. He was afraid of the suffering and the pain that he would endure physically. But I dare to say that had nothing to do with it. Jesus wasn't afraid. He said, I came to do the Father's will. I must be about my Father's will. He was completely committed and surrendered to the Father's will. It wasn't the pain. It wasn't the suffering. It wasn't the cross. It wasn't even the betrayal. It wasn't even what he knew would take place with his closest people, with his closest disciple. Listen, one would betray him in Judas. One would deny him in Peter. They all would forsake him. He would be all alone. He would face everything he would have to go through alone. But it wasn't even the loneliness. It wasn't even that that was causing Jesus so much pain, so much difficulty, so much stress that he felt like he would die. He said, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. You say, preacher, what could it have been? How bad was this pain? How bad was this agony? Dr. Luke began to describe, and it would be appropriate for him to write this because he was a physician. And as he described this event that took place in the garden, this is what Dr. Luke said. In Luke chapter 22, verse 44, it says, and being in agony, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweat was as it were great drops of blood falling to ground. What does that mean? That means that Jesus was under such pressure. He was praying in such agony. He was praying in such fervency that he began to sweat. And as he was praying and as he was seeking his Father and as he was asking his Father to answer his prayer, that the pressure became so great and the difficulty became so great that he began to sweat. And as he began to sweat, the capillaries in his pores began to burst and blood began to pour out. That is so what we see in the olive press. The olives are pressed. The olives are under pressure. And because of the pressure, that the oil comes out of the press. Jesus is being pressed in this matter. What in the world could cause him to be under such agony? What in the world could cause him if it wasn't the cross, if it wasn't the whips, if it wasn't the nails, if it wasn't the suffering, if it wasn't death itself, what could it have been? Oh, I want to submit to you today that he was holy. He was the perfect, spotless Lamb of God. As we find later on that in the courts, they found him not guilty. They said, we can find no fault in him because he was perfect. He was holy. Now, we can't even fathom this. Our minds are so corrupt in our heart. We have such a weakness in our flesh that we cannot understand or comprehend the concept of how pure and how holy and how righteous that God truly is and how Jesus truly was. And the Bible teaches us, and listen, in Hebrews chapter number 12, Hebrews chapter number 12, it says, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him. Think about this. This is where we learn. This is where we find out what was in the cup. He said, let this cup pass from me. What was in that cup? What was he saying? God, if there be any other way, let this cup. What was in the cup? It says this in Hebrews 12, verse 3. For consider, think about this, he says. Consider, think about this. Him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds, ye have not resisted unto blood, striving against sin. What is he saying? It is saying here in Hebrews, in the simplest way I can explain it, that his holiness was so pure, his righteousness was so real, that Jesus was so holy and so pure and so righteous that the very thought of becoming sin was so horrifying to him. The thought of the sin of mankind coming upon him, he that knew no sin but became sin. Say, preacher, what was happening? We find that the Father was going to take every sin of every man and place it on his Son. And he who knew no sin, he who was perfectly holy, would take the sin of mankind. Look what it says in Isaiah 53:5. It says, but he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Now watch this now. This is so important. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone into his own way. Watch here. And the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity, the sins, the wickedness, all of the failures of man. He put on Jesus in that garden. Jesus looked into that cup and he saw every rape, every murder, every incestuous act, every homosexual act, every single deed of sin, every Holocaust, every situation, every single sin of man. And God was going to take that and put on him, because Jesus was giving his life for the sins of man. He had to take the punishment. He had to take the judgment for sin. And in order to do that, he that knew no sin had to become sin. And according to Hebrews, it was such a contradiction of who he was. It was such the opposite of his holiness that he begged, is there any other way? In horror, he seen the holy Lamb of God, seen the sin of this world. He said, Oh, Father, if it be possible, if there's any other way, let this cup pass from me. Thank you. in this prayer, Jesus is always teaching. He's always teaching to show us how to live and how to behave, how to deal with temptation, how to deal with struggles. And this is no different. In this prayer that Jesus makes in this garden, he's teaching us how to respond to temptation, how to respond when there's something bigger than you, when there's something that you cannot accomplish. You see, we see in this, the first thing he does, he goes to his Father. He goes to his Father. And man, this is an amazing thing that we see, his relationship with God the Father. He uses the word Abba, Abba Father. Abba means Papa or Daddy. It's a term of endearment. And he is seeing and teaching us, just like he said, when you pray, say, Our Father, which is in heaven. When you're going through a battle, when you're going through a difficulty, when you're going through something that's bigger than you are, you need to run to the Father. This is not the time to run away from God. This is not the time. I see so many people, when difficulties come in their life, the first thing they do is quit church or leave church and get angry at God or run from God. That's not the time to run from God. That's the time to run to God. When you're going through a difficult time, Jesus said, my soul is exceeding sorrowful, even unto death. Listen, he is facing the demons of hell alone. He's facing the devil himself alone. He knows that there's coming a time when his own Father is going to have to turn his back, and he comes to him for the strength that he needs. And he says, Abba, Father, I know all things are possible with thee. I know you can do anything you want to do. He said, if there be any other way, besides me having to become sin, besides the perfect, holy Son of God becoming the sin of this world upon his back to pay, is there any other way? But then he says this, and this is what I need you to get. And this is what I need you to understand. You see, he says, not my will, but thy will be done. Not my will, but thy will be done. There many centuries before this, and even before the fall of man, we find that there was an angel who was beautiful, who was the highest of all angels, who was the most privileged of all angels. His name was Lucifer. Lucifer, as we know as Satan, he decided that he was going to be higher than God. And he said, I will ascend into heavens. I will have my throne above the Most High. I will. Not what God wills, but what I will. And we know he fell because of his pride, because of his arrogant attitude. He fell into condemnation. And then we find because of his influence, the first Adam in the garden, instead of saying, not my will, but thy will be done. Instead of saying, it's not about what I want, Father, it's about what you want. I appreciate the home you've given me. I appreciate the family you've given me. I appreciate this paradise you have put me in. I thank you, and because of my appreciation, I want to put you first. I desire your will to be done. No, that's not what happened. The first Adam sinned. He said, not what you want, God, but what I want. I know what you commanded me. I know what you told me, but I want what I want. I desire what I want. And he took of the fruit and disobeyed. But here we find the last Adam, as Paul said in 1 Corinthians, the last Adam said, not my will, but thy will be done. Not my will. I know I wish there was another way. If there's another way for man to be redeemed, if there's another way for man to be delivered, if there's another way for man to be forgiven, listen, oh, Father, will you show me that way? But not my will, thy will be done. Thy will be done. What do we learn about this? What do we learn? There's such an important lesson that we need to see and we need to learn about prayer. Prayer is not, now listen closely. Everybody listen, we're almost done. Listen real close to what I'm fixing to tell you. Prayer is not bending God's will to our will. Prayer is not getting God to do what we want him to do. If that's what you think, if that's how you practice your prayer, then you've missed it totally and completely. That is not what prayer is. You see, in the prayer, the model of prayer that Jesus gave his disciples, he said, pray in this manner. He wasn't saying, just repeat these words after me. He said, this is the outline of prayer. This is the model. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. You know what that means? Lord, let me do here what you've got planned for me up there. In other words, it is submitting to the will of God for your life. It is saying, not my will, but thy will be done. Every day that you wake up, every day that you live, you should live your life in total submission to the will of God. Not saying, God, I need you to do this, and God, I want you to do this. God, I want you to do what I want you to do. There's so many people, that's their prayer, that's their operation, that's their method. It's not about finding God's will and obeying. It's about trying to make God do what we want him to do. Jesus teaches us so clearly in this chapter. It's not bending God's will to ours. It's bending our will to his and submitting. Adam didn't submit. He rebelled. But we see the last Adam, the Lord Jesus Christ. He submitted in this garden. He submitted to the will of the Father. You see, Jesus died before he ever got to the cross. He died to his own will in the garden. He prayed three different times. He come back to the Father. This battle was so intense. This struggle with Satan. Satan was attacking him. I believe Satan was attacking him in the garden just like he did in the wilderness, trying to get him to do his own will, trying to get him to be willful and disobedient to his Father. But he said, not my will, thy will be done. And I need you to understand this. God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. If you're here today and you don't know Christ, and you've been living your life according to your own will, doing your own thing, I want you to take a moment and say, not my will. Not my will, but thy will be done. God desires you to be submissive to him. God desires you to repent and turn from your old life, turn from your old ways. You see, it's a dark moment in the garden. It's a dark time of loneliness for Jesus here in this garden. He is in extreme agony to the point that his capillaries are bursting and his sweat has become as great drops of blood. But that's not the end of the story. The Bible says in Philippians that he humbled himself even unto death, the death of the cross. And because of that, God hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. Listen, your submission to him is just the beginning of life. And today, will you submit? Today, will you surrender your life to Christ? Will you be like the last Adam and not like the first Adam? Will you give God your life today? I want to show you how. I want to show you how to submit today. This is the invitation. Guys, if you want to come and get ready for the music, if you're here today and you've never submitted and surrendered your life to Jesus, this is how you do it. You must first recognize that you're a sinner. You must recognize that you have failed and rebelled as the first Adam did in the garden. And because of our sin, we're under condemnation. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. In Romans 6:23, the Bible says that the wages of sin is death. Is death. Sin has to be paid for. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. It says in Romans 5:8 that God commendeth his love. The word commendeth means to put on display. But God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He died for you and he died for me. And if you will believe that, he says in Romans 10:9-10, if we will confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Listen, I want you to submit today. I want you to say to the Lord today, not my will, but thy will be done. We're going to sing a verse in just a moment. And if you're here today and you're not 100% sure, if you were to die right now, that you would go to heaven. When we start singing this verse, I want you to step out of your pew. Don't wait. Don't procrastinate. Don't make any excuses. You step out of that pew. There's going to be somebody there at the altar to take a Bible and show you how you can be saved. Would you come today? Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for your mercy and your grace. Thank you for those who are gathered in this building this morning. I pray that you will touch those who don't know you. I pray that you will help them understand that life begins at a time of surrender to the Lord. Lord, I pray that if there's someone here that's not saved, please let them come right now. As soon as this verse begins, as soon as the music starts, I pray that they will step out of their pew and come forward. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.